good morning. Welcome to Discovery Church. We are doing something new and different today. We are broadcasting live from Discovery Church, and we have a small audience of 9 people. So we're below the 10 minimum, or maximum, actually. And we're doing this for a couple of reasons. First of all, for our folks that don't have electronic means to watch on Facebook Live and or don't have internet or so on and so forth, we're doing this for them. They're here today, and we're going to be rotating a schedule of people throughout the weeks to come so everyone gets an opportunity to be at the church. And we're also doing this for you, those who are able to tune into us through Facebook Live and or might watch this on YouTube or something of that nature later on down the line. A couple of announcements to share with you. First and foremost, today is Palm Sunday. It's a very important day on the Christian calendar, and I want to share a message with you today about Palm Sunday. That means that next Sunday is Easter Sunday. Today, we normally, the first Sunday of the month, we would have the Lord's Supper, but we're not going to do that this Sunday. We're going to do it next Sunday. And here's how we're going to attempt to do that. We're going to ask you sometime between now and then to go get your own communion supplies. Go get your own bread, go get your own juice of choice, whatever it is. I had to look at Tom because he and I were having a conversation about it earlier this week. Whatever your juice of choice is, next week when we have our moment of observing the Lord's Supper, we'll do it as much the normal traditional way as we can. There will still be a blessing for the cup and for the bread and so on and so forth. But you'll just take it at your home whenever you're ready to do so. More about that next Sunday. Just use this time between now and next Sunday to get your communion supplies and have them ready next Sunday. We'll have an Easter message, but we will probably do something in the not too distant future when all this quarantine kind of stuff is over, and something a little more Easterish here together corporately as a church. And you know what? You don't realize what you've got until it's gone, and you don't really miss something until it's taken away. And hoping that sometime in the near future we'll all be back together and everyone is going to want to be at church. And I'm hoping and praying that a lot of people come to Jesus through all of this. But for now, let's have a word of prayer. Tom is here. He's going to lead us in worship. And Ali's going to be playing the piano. Sharon's running the sound. And we've got a few folks, just a few, and they're more than 6 feet apart, just in case anyone's watching. Anyway, Lord, thank you for this day and your many, many blessings. Thank you that you've given to us a creative opportunity that we can have worship still be in your house, that we can come and meet with you and one another in a small but meaningful kind of way. And thank you for the video platform of Facebook Live that we can project to the folks that are unable to be here. And we're abiding by the rules of the land so far. And thank you that you've given us this opportunity that we can come into the homes and lives of those who are our family and our friends and part of the Discovery Church family. Lord, bless this time. Use this as an opportunity to reveal yourself, to exact your good, pleasing, and perfect will in your church, in our lives, in our homes even, and draw us closer to you. We want to hear from you, God. We want to feel your presence. We want to be able to say that we have been touched by you in some meaningful way today. We thank you, Lord. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
As we come to worship, we are going to sing a couple of hymns which reflect what the crowd was doing on Palm Sunday. We're going to be singing praises to Jesus. So the first song is Fairest Lord Jesus.
We will.
Praise Him.
Praise Him.
www.discoverychurchvb.org. There's a donate tab on the right hand side towards the top. Just click on that little tab, it'll take you right to the donate page, and you can again see all the ways that you can give. You can also do a draft from your bank to our bank. You would have to go to your bank to set that up, or you can set it up online. We can also send a check to Discovery Church. We are located at 4881 Euclid Road, Virginia Beach, Virginia, 23462. And there are a couple who are here today. I neglected to put the treasure chest by the doors, but there's a treasure chest down the hallway. At some point before you leave today, go just walk down there. Be sure to be 6 feet apart or more and drop your offering in the treasure chest, and we will make sure it gets where it needs to go. Let's pray for the offering, shall we? Lord, thank you that you have provided for us so many creative ways that we can give to you. Help us to be ever mindful that that is what we're doing. We are giving to you. We are being faithful stewards of what you have blessed us with. That is our lives. That is our love. That is our freedom. That is the money that you've given to us in a variety of ways. That we would be, you have entrusted us with all of these things to be good stewards thereof. Lord, impress upon us how we might give the way that you would be honored and glorified. I know that you are a generous giver, God. You've challenged us to be equally as generous unto you. Take these tithes, these offerings. Bless each one. Bless each giver. Those who want to give also, God, provide for them the means and the ways that they might give as well, so that they might be faithful to you, and that they might see your will done in their lives, and that you might bless their giving, bless their homes, their lives, their families. Lord, show yourself in a real and meaningful way as we give today. Take these offerings as gifts of love to you. Receive them in such a way that you receive all praise for it. We're going to praise him, we're going to praise you, and we're going to thank you carefully for your many blessings. It's in Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
And we're going to sing now Hosanna. It's video. Enjoy it. Feel free to sing along. Sing at the top of your lungs if you want.
Hosanna in the highest.
mean, save us now. Indeed, we need saving, don't we? Well, again, today is Palm Sunday, and I hope that we'll all be made a little bit more aware of the significance of this day in all of Christendom. And this day, the events of this day, as recorded throughout the Synoptic Gospels, is a message about living triumphantly, living victoriously, and being and overcoming the circumstances of this life. In particular, this was an exuberant day of praise. This was a huge celebration. You know, people get excited over some of the smallest things. Right now, people are getting excited over finding toilet paper in the grocery store. That's just the way that it is. But you know what? I'm intentionally not going to talk about the virus of the day. I believe we've talked about it a lot, and we can talk about it even more. Will you mute this? We can talk about that until, you know, the kingdom comes. Mm-hmm. But let's talk about the Word of God.
Amen.
Let's move away from the things that are going on around us and talk about what is coming and how you and I can live a victorious life, even though the message is a bittersweet victory that will make sense to you as we go along. Like I said, people get excited over some of the smallest and littlest things, but living triumphantly and victoriously is so much more than the little pleasures of this life. However, I want to share with you from Mark's Gospel, chapter 11, verses 1 through 10, and I'll also reference Luke 19 and or 22 and so on and so forth, but just for now, we're going to focus on Mark 11, 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' tell him, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here shortly.' They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied in a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, 'What are you doing untying that colt?' They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom, the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest.' Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the temple. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. And I pray God will bless the reading of his word in our presence today, and those of you in your homes or watching wherever you might be. Again, I said I'm going to reference a few of the other accounts in the Synoptic Gospels about Palm Sunday and about the triumphal entry of Jesus. Well, Jesus, not to repeat anything, but just to kind of give you an overview and a snapshot, Jesus was walking down the road from Jericho to Jerusalem. And Bethany and Bethpage were not too far. And they were on the journey, and they're not too far from each other. Kind of like Virginia Beach and Portsmouth, you know, about that distance. Of course, that's a long walk for those of us who aren't used to walking that far. But nonetheless, he had just restored the sight of Bartimaeus in Mark 10, 46 through 52, and had taught about the parable of the 10 minas. You know, those little teeny tiny mites, the widow's mite, and how much a little mina would be, and about the 10 minas in particular, talents and so on and so forth. This was the beginning of Holy Week. This is what's important. This day, this triumphal entry, Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, and this was the very first day of Holy Week. It is what has also been named as the Passion Week. The Passion of Christ. You've heard about that, maybe even seen the movie. This was the beginning of a week-long celebration of the Passover. In Exodus chapter 12, 37 through 51, we find that God had told his people to remember the Exodus and how he delivered them from their bondage and slavery in Egypt, and that this would be a celebration for perpetual generations. This would never end. And so this is a seven-day long, I hesitate to say party, but celebration of deliverance from being enslaved. And they were enslaved for over 400 years. Certainly this would be an incredible celebration. And to look back and to see what God had done and how he delivered them in a mighty way. And so God said, do this, celebrate this every year. So Jews would come from all over the known world, and they would descend upon Jerusalem, and Jerusalem would be packed to the gills almost as they were coming for this festival. And many people, have you ever been to an event or registered for an event and you know there was a celebrity that was going to be there and you just couldn't wait to see that celebrity? It's okay to speak up. They'll catch your voice on Facebook Live, but you might even add to the whole experience. But if you've ever registered for an event or looking forward to something and you thought some dignitary might be there, you might want to see that person or talk to that person. That same kind of enthusiasm and excitement and energy would have pervaded the hearts and minds of the Jewish people. They're celebrating the deliverance, God's mighty hand having delivered his people from bondage and slavery. And there, this year was going to be possibly a well-known person. Someone that they had heard about who was performing miracles, restoring the sight to the blind, healing leprous people, raising the dead. Certainly there would have been energy and excitement about that kind of person. And so they were anticipating and looking forward to maybe seeing Jesus at this Passover. And so that kind of let that thought or experience maybe pervade your hearts and minds as you project yourself into that time that you were excited about possibly seeing Jesus. And knowing that so many people, Jews especially in particular, were going to be in Jerusalem that week, this was the now appointed time for Jesus to reveal himself as the Messiah, as the deliverer of God's people. This was also coinciding with really the final event to infuriate the chief priests and the religious elite of the day. Because when Jesus did what he did on this Palm Sunday, okay, that's it. We've had enough of this guy. Now he's claiming to be the anointed one. That would have infuriated the religious elite. But unfortunately, and here's really where the bittersweet victory comes in. Unfortunately, many people did not understand what the Messiah would be like and what he would come to do. For centuries, Jews longed for freedom from their oppressors. They had been enslaved and captured by one group of people in one empire after another and occupied by this one and that one. And at the current time, they were in occupation, or they were being occupied, Israel was occupied by the Roman Empire. And they were oppressing God's people like all the others did. And so God's people, the Jews, they looked forward to their Messiah being a deliverer of God's people in a mighty, victorious kind of way, but perhaps not in the way that Jesus came. They were looking for someone who would be a national leader, maybe a military leader or a political leader, who would vanquish their foes and rescue them once and for all, setting up Israel as the new leading nation of the known world. That's what the people wanted. But you know what? Jesus didn't come that way. He entered into the world as a baby, wrapped in swaddling clothes and birthed in a manger, a cave of all things. Certainly not royalty like the world would think of. Jesus came as a lowly, humble carpenter. And he did not come riding into Jerusalem on the back of a steed. Stout, mighty, and strong, and beautiful. He came riding in on a lowly, humble donkey. The colt, foal of a donkey. This would hardly have been what people would have expected of a king coming. part of this anticipation of the Jewish Messiah coming was that there would be the establishment of peace along with his arrival. That he would usher in a peace like the world had never seen before. And certainly, for centuries, maybe even millennia, God's people had not known peace. And so they would have looked forward to peace finally being brought to their people and to their nation. As they approached Jerusalem, Jesus and his disciples reached the Mount of Olives, just east of the city. Now this is about 2,700 feet above sea level. That's not a mountain necessarily, but it is a very, very large hill, if you will. Although around there, I guess we would call 2,700 feet a mountain. Colorado might laugh at us. But anyway, what's important is the vantage point, the view of the holy city of Jerusalem from on top of the Mount of Olives. It's about 200 feet taller than Mount Zion. But what an incredible view there would have been as Jesus and his disciples would look out over top and see the holy city, and with great anticipation knowing what was about to happen. And so they had a magnificent view of the holy city, and specifically the temple. And this very day, this event and this very day were prophesied some 500 years beforehand by the prophet Zechariah. Zechariah 9:9 says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." You see, this prophecy had been foretold 500 plus years earlier that Jesus, the Messiah, the King of the Jews, would arrive on the back of a donkey, not a stallion. Faithful Jews who read the scriptures and knew the truth of the scriptures would have known the significance of Jesus riding on a donkey that day. Many were celebrating. In fact, most people were celebrating. They just had the wrong perspective on what their Messiah was going to be like. Now, Zechariah was among some 50,000 Jews who had returned from Babylonian exile in 538 BC, and he was encouraging God's people with the words, "Your king is coming." That would have been words, that would have been like, oh gosh, that would have been music to their ears. "Man, I'm so glad. We've been now in captivity for 70 years in Babylon. We're now being allowed to go back to our homeland, looking forward to the temple being rebuilt. And guess what? Zechariah is encouraging us, hey, the king is coming, the king is coming, the king is coming." There would have been all kinds of excitement for God's people. And then fast forward to 500 years on this day that Jesus comes riding into Jerusalem, the holy city, on this donkey that Zechariah had prophesied about, they would have been incredibly excited. And I just wonder why sometimes today, when we know so much more than what they knew then, how come we don't get excited about the arrival of King Jesus?
Amen, amen.
I hope some of you on Facebook Live are shouting and jumping for joy and, I don't know, whatever, having a good old time praising him. You see, the long-awaited Messianic King from the line of David was going to arrive, and he would bring with him peace and salvation. Granted, they wanted peace in a worldly sense, and they wanted salvation or rescue from their oppressors. But Jesus said, "I don't come to give peace the way the world does, and I've not come necessarily to rescue you from your oppressors. I have come to give you my peace."
Amen. Hallelujah.
And the peace that Jesus comes to bring is peace with God the Father through the forgiveness of sin and reconciliation of us to God. And the salvation that he brings is eternal life. Not vanquishing our foes or enemies. Jesus would come as the Lamb, as John said in 1:29, who takes away the sins of the world. And Mark 10:45 says that Jesus had come to give his life as a ransom for many. In John 14:27, he says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives." But he followed up by saying, "Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not not be afraid. Jesus came to bring peace with the Father, not the absence of conflict in the world. Now the story continues, though, that Jesus had sent two of his disciples, and the Bible doesn't reveal to us which ones. It might have been Peter and James or Peter and John, one of the three leaders within the group. He sent them ahead to Bethpage to get this donkey. And this was a young donkey. And the scripture says, and it's very important, it says, has never been ridden. No one's ever ridden on the back of this donkey. And it says a lot about this animal. Jesus often used the unconventional, the unapproved, and the unaccepted. Not only was the donkey an unclean animal by Jewish standards, but it was a lowly and peaceful animal, and not an animal of war, like a horse. But this was a suitable choice for the Messiah, who was to be, as Zechariah prophesied, gentle and humble in nature.
Amen.
Not only this, but the book of Judges describes the donkey as being a princely mount, as well as 2 Samuel 16:2. The donkey was considered to be a noble animal in ancient times, and even King David and his sons used mules as their royal mounts, not horses. Additionally, by riding an animal that is considered to be a beast of burden, it symbolizes that Jesus was sending the message to us that he came to bear our burdens in himself. Think about that for just a moment. Mm-hmm. Jesus came to bear the sins of the world in his own body. Symbolically, and maybe I'm reading a little bit into this, just allow me a little bit of poetic license here, if you will, that Jesus riding this beast of burden means that he came to bear the burden of our sin upon himself. Given the fact that this colt had never been ridden, and Jesus was able to just get right on the back and ride, also shows his dominion over the animal kingdom. You let you or me get on the back of a never ridden donkey, it's probably not going to be a very fun experience for either one of us. But anyway, I could really go somewhere. I have to censor myself on things like that. One of us might be a jack that day. But anyway, we'll just leave it at that. Jesus explained to his disciples that if anyone asked them what they were doing, just tell them the Lord needs it. And that seemed to be satisfactory. I don't know about you, but if I'm having a conversation with someone, and then someone says, hey, go get this donkey, basically, go take it, and just tell them what the Lord needs, and I'm going to go, but what if I, or what if they, just tell them the Lord needs it. Okay. It may have been that the owner or owners of this donkey were God-fearing people. Mm-hmm. It may have been that they were unnamed disciples of Jesus already. Mm-hmm. But the disciples didn't know that. These two disciples did not know that. But the words, the Lord needs it, seemed to be satisfactory to them. Okay. More dominion being illustrated and shown to us by the Lord. And it reveals that he was Lord. When Jesus said, the Lord needs it, this is the first time that Jesus ever referred to himself as the Lord. Clearly, that was him saying, I'm the Messiah. I'm the long-awaited Son of God, Son of Man, the deliverer of God's people. Tell them that the Lord needs it.
Amen.
That seemed to be enough. And you know what should be enough for us today? The Lord needs it. When he made the statement about himself, he revealed his identity as Yahweh, the God, the Jehovah God, the God of heaven and earth, the creator of all. He revealed that he is the Lord. And this further angered those chief priests and, of course, the Pharisees, and it only added to their reasons for wanting to kill him. Now, these two disciples, they came back to this donkey, and they just took off their coats. Laid on his back, a makeshift saddle, and Jesus sat on the donkey, rode into Jerusalem. As he was riding this donkey down the road, people would cut branches from nearby plants, kind of like these palms here and here. And palms and palm branches are considered to be an extension of the hand. They have these finger-like branches to them and leaves on them. And they're often used in celebration. Now, this was the first real opportunity and first real evidence of this being done for Jesus. Some put their garments on the road as Jesus rode the donkey. And the act of spreading one's garments before a dignitary was a Jewish custom that symbolized their submission to royalty. This was further acknowledgement of Jesus' claim as the Messiah. And this especially is the submission and acknowledgement of Jesus as King. Palm branches then were spread over the road were symbols of goodness and victory. Hence the words triumphal entry. Victory was at hand. Our King has arrived. Our King has come. We're now going to win. We're going to be delivered. Our foes are going to be vanquished. And peace is going to be established in the world. And we have nothing but celebration for this time. And that's what the people were doing. They were waving their hands and waving those palm branches. And they were singing, Hosanna, save us now. Rescue us now. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. He said, I am the Lord. Palm branches, Palm Sunday. They're often depicted on coins and important buildings. For example, in 1 Kings 6:29, Solomon had palm branches carved into the walls and doors of the temple. Revelation 7, 9, and 10, they tell us a lot about palm branches. Now, granted, this is at some point in the future, but listen to this. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. Now what this is an incredible picture of a time yet to come when all of those who are saved, all those who know Jesus as Savior and Lord and Rescuer and Redeemer, this is a time when you and I will be worshiping God and we will be waving our branches of triumph and victory, and we will be so excited in this moment. It's because of our victorious life in Christ. You see, we have victory now, but we're going to have an incredible victory later on. We've got the eternal life waiting for us, but we're already living part of that now, knowing that it is a sure thing in Christ Jesus. The followers of Jesus were expressing their hope in him as their deliverer, redeemer, and savior, and the one who would bring them victory. It's incredible that you and I know and realize that victory is already won. Jesus said on the cross, it is finished. It's done. The devil just hasn't given up yet.
That's right.
One day he will. As they laid down these branches, they shouted, Hosanna, which means what?
Save us now.
Save us now. But the townspeople, fast forward into Luke 19:41. The townspeople did not recognize Jesus as the Messiah who would bring them peace. And you know what Jesus did? He looked out across the crowd and across the city, and while they were celebrating, he knew. These are going to be the same people at the end of the week who shout, crucify him. Crucify him. Crucify him.
Yes.
The Bible says that he wept over the city and their unbelief.
Mm-hmm.
You see, many people want Jesus to be this or that. They want him to give them things and do things for them and so on and so forth. And they believe in Jesus. But you know, you have to believe on Jesus. You have to accept that He is the Savior. He is the Messiah. He is the Redeemer. He is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And by faith, trust Him now with your life so that you might have the life that is truly life, the life that is eternal awaiting you. And so Jesus saw their rejection of Him as the Messiah, the real identity of the Messiah who would deliver God's people from their sin and set them aright with God. You know, many people make the same mistake today. And this is the bittersweet victory. Sweet because people were chanting, "Hosanna, save us now." They wanted rescue. They wanted redemption. They wanted God and they wanted Jesus to deliver them from their physical oppressors. But they missed the fact that He is the deliverer of our souls.
Amen.
The one who gives eternal life. Why is this important today? Well, if you've been saved by Jesus, if you by faith believe in Him, and you don't have to have all the answers figured out. You just trust that He'll do what He said He would do. I'm going to build a mansion for you. I'm going to take you to be where I am. You're going to live forever. You just trust Him. He's going to do it. Going to means it hasn't happened yet. It hasn't been fully realized, but it's a promise. He's going to do it. You have to believe and live your life for Him now. And so if you've been saved, you've already triumphed. You're already victorious. The battle is won. The victory is sealed. The devil just hasn't given up yet. I said it earlier. Jesus often does things differently than what you and I want. And He often does things in a way that I mentioned earlier, uncommon, unconventional, and unexpected. If you have not accepted Jesus as your Messiah, just like the townspeople that day in Jerusalem, He weeps, He grieves for you. He wants you to believe in Him, and He wants you to give your life to Him. And you know, as much as the people there that day did not fully understand what was going on, they were not afraid to express their praise and adoration. Because they believed that victory was won. They believed that their King had come. How much more so should you and I, and all of us in the Facebook Live family, how much more should you and I praise Him, praise the Lord, praise Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who has actually done what He said He would do? It's not fully realized yet, but it's coming. They expressed, though, their praise in an oriental style of jubilation. They didn't have full understanding, but they let their praise rattle the rooftops and reverberate over the hills. And so then how much more should you and I praise the Lord? Much more so. Well, today, in light of the message and the title being a bittersweet victory, bitter because there are some today still who reject Jesus as Savior. But it's sweet for those, for any and all who will and do, because the victory is won. This is a day of exuberant praise and worship. And living this victorious life, priceless. To know that you've been washed whiter than snow and cleansed from all sin and iniquity, to be granted peace with God, the Father through Jesus' blood should make you the most grateful, most joy-filled, victorious person of all, because through Christ you have the same victory. And you know what? Romans 8:37 says, "You are more than conquerors through Him who loved us." And over this life, you will receive the life that is truly life when this one comes to a close. You know what? We all need some victory today. Amen?
Amen.
We all need to know that God's got it all under control, and the victory is won. We're going to sing right now, Victory in Jesus. Stand, even if you're at home, stand, sing with us. Allie's making her way to the piano. Tom's making his way to the platform. We're going to sing, and we're going to shout, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And we're going to be victory. We're going to sing victory in Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Aren't you victorious today?
Yes.
Sing it like you mean it.